Well, good for DEF CON for realizing that a very important person is sitting to my right, and he needs to be heard. And if he can't get on that stage, he's on this stage. So, can everybody see me just a little bit here? Sort of? Yeah. And you can hear me. I'm Jane Harman. I'm a recovering politician. And I am thrilled to be just beneath the main stage at DEF CON with a group of folks who come from very different communities, members of Congress and hackers. I spent 17 years, count that, as a member of Congress. That's 10,001 in binary, and sometimes it's felt like 10,001 years. I left in 2011 to head the Wilson Center. Many of you may know it, and if you don't, what you need to know is that at this con are 15 senior staffers to members of Congress, plus these members, senior staffers who have come here, some Republicans, some Democrats, all mixed up to learn from this amazing con and this amazing audience. So thank you for teaching them. Over my years in Congress, my 10,001 years in Congress, I learned that politics is analog, but the world and the problems politicians confront is digital. Some politicians are worse offenders than others. These guys get it. But a whole bunch of folks, I think they're still out there in the United States Congress, are still using flip phones. And we are here today to see whether the hackers in Congress, the hackers and some of the more advanced people in Congress can help bridge the divide. Trillions of dollars are being lost to breaches and destructive cyber attacks, as you all know, plus lives are being put at risk if critical services are cut off by bad actors. 30,000 people are here at this con with a keen interest in hacking and in many cases with extraordinary skills. The U.S. Congress needs you. Today we're going to try to hack Congress in 45 minutes, probably would take a lot less than that, and to explain how you can help. And if we don't work now to translate between the traditional silos of our two communities, then we will miss opportunities, you know this, to consider what solutions exist. No one solves problems in isolation. Something this amazing community knows. So, before you, right surrounding me, sit two real-life current members of Congress. Jim Langevin, right here, dear friend of mine, is a DEF CON repeater, get that, from Rhode Island's 2nd Congressional District. And Ted Lieu, on my left, media star, you see him all the time, is from California's 33rd, yay, Ted, congressional district. This crowd has no, this is great. Jim and I served together in the House through the dark days, and they were, after 9/11. He currently sits on the House Armed Services Committee, the Homeland Security Committee, and he previously served on the House Intelligence Committee. He's known for his efforts to improve America's cybersecurity enterprise, co-founder and co-chair of the bipartisan Congressional Cybersecurity Caucus, and he's authored numerous bills to protect personal data and improve our government's coordination efforts against cyber attacks. That's what we're going to talk about. Ted Lieu is also a member of the Congressional Cybersecurity Caucus. He represents the South Bay of Los Angeles, which is where most of the aerospace in California is. And guess what? Most of that was my former congressional district. So yay for TED. A lot of technology is developed there, as I said, and I remember about 20 years ago or so meeting a kid named Elon who was making rockets on the sawdust floor in his rental in El Segundo. TED is one of the only four computer scientists in Congress. Get that, there are four, that's better than zero. And he's a colonel in the Air Force Reserves. As an added bonus, he's a lawyer. So am I, so go ahead and boo. And a founding co-chair of the Congressional Virtual Reality Caucus. I actually think some of Congress is virtual reality. Side by side, these policymakers are two genuine hackers. InfoSec Jen and Space Rogue. Figure out who's who. Jen Ellis is awesome. She heads Rapid7's policy team and dedicates most of her time to helping government understand information security issues. Thank you for that from a grateful nation. She records a cool podcast, works to fix problems in outdated laws, most of them are outdated, and hosts a killer party at DEF CON. I went last night, thank you for including me. Space Rogue is a security researcher whose reputation precedes him. Today he is global hacking strategy lead for X-Force Red. How do you put that on a card, or do you?
It's a big card.
Big card, at IBM. Space, please don't hack my iPhone, or if you do, leave the pictures of my grandkids. So, imagine this, let's get into it. A massive destructiveware attack, diagnosed as ransomware, similar to NotPetya, shuts down hospitals and train stations and pick whatever you want across either of your congressional districts and costs companies there billions of dollars. Or a horrible twist, a domestic terrorist, and we certainly have learned about that if we didn't already know about it, could shoot up a shopping mall at home while carrying out a denial of service attack on the mall's phone infrastructure. So let's start with our congresspeople. What do you do if that happens, all of that, part of that, as a member of Congress? Who do you call? What happens? Jim.
Well, Jane, first of all, I want to thank you and the Wilson Center for hosting us here today. I am a DEF CON repeater, and I'm thrilled to be back. I was here 2 years ago and thoroughly enjoyed the experience. Importantly, I learned a lot and gave me the opportunity to engage with some really talented cyber researchers, and I appreciate the time we spent then and the opportunity to be back now and to be here with my colleague, Ted Liu. And together, one of the handful of few that really get cybersecurity and how important it is to the country. And honored to be here with the panelists. And Jane, again, thank you for your leadership of the Wilson Center. Jane and I served in Congress, as she mentioned, for many years. And we have nothing but the deepest respect for Jane Harman. And it was lost to the Congress when she left. Jane, anytime you want to come back, the water's fine. Come on back. So. Probably
I'd rather
no shot.
I'd rather come back to DEF CON.
Me too. Yeah. So let me say this. We would hope that the right processes right now are in place, that we would have a whole of government, whole of nation response to a major cyber incident. That would be, in many ways, though, we have to wait to be seen. We there after the several high-profile cyber intrusions or hacks that took place. There was a process put together, PPD 41 under President Obama, that basically laid out what would happen if there were ever a need for a national incident response team to be put together. And so the policy is in place. Now, whether it can be effectively executed, bringing all the entities together and without infighting is sort of, we'd have to hope for the best, but we need to practice it. That's the key thing. It needs to be exercised and drilled over and over again. Now, the closest thing we have that took place was clearly after the 2016 elections, where we were totally caught off guard by the degree to which the Russians were going to interfere with our elections. We were not caught off guard in 2018. We did have a more of a whole of nation, whole of government response put in place, and we were much better protected in 2018, but not perfect. It's still a work in progress. The Russians, we believe, will be back again in 2020, and there are further preparations that are put in place that are ongoing right now to make sure that we are protecting our election system and our infrastructure going forward. That being said, and the last thing, I'll wind up with this. We now, though, had to be able to take that whole of government response, and we also need to make sure that it would apply in other areas of national incident of great consequence, so that we would be able to recover and build resilience, but make sure that we're exercising this so that it becomes a real strong muscle memory.
Well, so Ted, just to ask you to add to that answer, on 9/11, when Jim and I were serving in Congress, I was walking toward the Capitol in the morning. My cell phone, yes, I had one, not a flip phone, rang, and I was told the Capitol and the office buildings have been evacuated. Congress is closed, if you can imagine this. We all take an oath to defend the country, but hey, Congress is closed. There was no evacuation plan. 250 members plus were milling around in front of the Capitol trying to figure out what our next act was. I was then the senior Democrat on the House Intelligence Committee. That's a job Adam Schiff had for a long time before he became the chairman. And we rounded up some of the members. We went into one guy's apartment, which was on the Hill, a basement apartment. And then we figured out we ought to do two things. One, we ought to mass at the headquarters, which were then close by, of the Capitol Police to see if we could get secure comms and be helpful. And the other thing we ought to work on is getting the Capitol opened so that Congress would be available to protect and at least serve the American people during the worst day in modern history. So Ted, now that you've heard that lovely story,
right,
is Congress prepared now for the kind of cyber incident that I was talking about?
No, we are not. Let me first say I'm thrilled to be here. The only inaccuracy in the introduction is that I'm a recovering computer science major. So just want to put that out there. I'm honored to be here with Jane Harman. Much of what I know in Congress, I learned from watching Jane Harman, who was an amazing member of Congress. So thank you for being my mentor. And to Congressman Jim Langevin, he mentioned his whole government approach. When a crisis hits, it is generally too late for Congress to act. We are not the executive branch. We don't sort of take immediate action. We pass laws and we do oversight, none of which is speedy or fast or quick. But what we can do is try to set up conditions and to put in laws that mitigate any future crisis. That's one reason that Jim Langevin and I are co-authoring a bill to establish a White House cyber security czar. If you look at how we do cyber in the federal government, it is pretty messed up. You've got the Department of Homeland Security that's sort of involved, then you've got our DOD that's sort of involved, then you've got, who knows why, the Office of Management and Budget, who's sort of involved, and then you've got the White House, which is sort of involved, and you sort of have the NSC, who was involved, and they eliminated their national security, their cyber security person. So it is all over the place, and if we could centralize a single point of contact, I think that would make things easier. In addition, when you sort of look at our cybersecurity, at least at the federal level, we're very weak. Space Rogue testified in 1998 yep. about how weak cybersecurity was. Nearly 20 years later, we were still there. I remember being in the House Oversight Committee when we discovered this massive breach of security clearance forms from the federal government. Nearly 20 million of these documents were stolen from a foreign country. Public reporting is it was likely China. These are extremely sensitive forms known as SF-86 forms. I filled them out when I was in the military. They ask you everything under the sun, every bad thing you've ever done, every person you've ever met as a foreign person. It is a treasure trove of blackmail. And now there's 20 million of these records floating around. And so our national security suffered a pretty significant hit, not because of any kinetic attack on us, but because there was a cyber intrusion. And it was the cybersecurity standards were so weak that the Inspector General's office, which was inspecting these agencies, actually started doing these reports saying, please increase your cybersecurity. And their last report said, essentially, shut down some of your systems because you can't protect them. Unfortunately, their director of the Office of Personnel Management did not do that, and we had this massive intrusion. The other thing that we did is, when you look at it, why would the Office of Personnel Management, which was essentially a human resources agency, protect what is known as the crown jewels of American national intelligence? It'd be like asking the Department of Agriculture to protect our nuclear launch codes. Really stupid. So I worked with Congressman Steve Russell then, a Republican out of Oklahoma, and we went to the Obama administration and said, you got to move this database out of there. They did this whole interagency review. They came back a few months later and agreed with us. So now it's being protected by U.S. Cyber Command in a much better place. So these are some things we can do in Congress to try to mitigate future crises. But when a crisis actually hits, there is very little Congress can do.
So, Jen, what if I turn on my cell phone later? It's off for now. And I have received a call from President Donald Trump. And he's asking me to find someone really smart, in fact, some two people really smart, to advise him on what the federal government should do right now to protect itself. What do you tell our president?
Where do I start with that question? Firstly, I'd just like to say hacking Congress in 45 minutes was not a challenge, guys, so don't get ideas, please. I think that whenever anybody's asked where do you start on how to secure yourself and to move forward, it's a super complex question, and it's a multi-layered question. I think that the first thing that you do is you bring as many sort of smart, informed people together as possible, and you have them educate each other, listen to each other, identify what the problem sets are, prioritize them, figure out what the right solutions
are. But this is Donald Trump we're talking about. He doesn't have a lot of time for this. Think about his presidential daily brief, which he doesn't have a lot of time for. So you've heard from both of these people, very informed members of Congress, some of the steps Congress is taking. You're on a phone call. You've got your 5 minutes.
And what's
you
the
say,
number one thing?
Yeah.
What is the number one thing? Yeah.
So I think one thing that we see, at least with this administration, that I have seen is that cyber, and yes, I'm going to use the C word because it's appropriate here in this context, that cyber in D.C. right now isn't really taken as a priority. So I would probably advise the president that there needs to be a higher focus and a closer look at what cyber is and how we can fix it, and let's put some dollars into it and some people and see where the problems are and how we can fix them.
But one of the recent steps he took, you heard this from our members, is he downgraded the cyber job in the White House. It was held by a man named Tom Bossert, who's pretty smart on cyber, my impression, certainly. He's now gone into the private sector. But not only did Bossert get fired, but his job was abolished. And I think the number of dollars, I don't know, folks, spent on cyber protection in the government has gone down in real terms, has it?
Well, it's still in the billions, but not nearly enough. And I think we need to do more in terms of building expertise within DHS and not just relying on reach back from other agencies. But the other thing that we need to do, I believe, is again, engage more with the cybersecurity research community. I've learned a lot by coming to DEF CON and understanding that the hackers, they like to break things, but they like to do it so that they can fix them and make the internet work better. And that's where we need to draw on that strength and leverage it as a country.
So, Jen, how do you bottle DEF CON?
So, that's a great question. There are lots of bottles. I would just say, though, quickly, that while I do think resourcing security appropriately and giving it a mandate is essential, I agree with Representative Liu that one of the challenges we have is there's a sort of chaotic approach. There's like a scattergun approach, and there's too many different voices involved. And like, I would worry with this sort of, Trumpian view of like, just give it money and tell them to go, that we're not gonna have a lot of strategy in how we go about it. I think having a centralized voice that is expert on this area is a good idea. And I think that, you know, to Congressman Langevin's point, if we can have that group work with this group, you know, as you say, bottling the security researchers and have the researchers providing the appropriate level of input in where are the real risks, how do we address those, what needs to be prioritized, that's when I think you make progress.
So one way that we're trying to engage the hacking community is to ask folks who are interested to help hack the federal government. And so I introduced a bill with Congressman Taylor, a Republican out of Virginia. It's called the Hack the Department of Homeland Security Act. It was signed into law earlier this year. It required DHS to do two things. One was to make an assessment of cyber vulnerabilities, and second, to create a bug bounty program to pay white hat hackers to hack DHS and to tell them what was wrong with the agency and to hopefully fix those bugs. If you're interested, contact DHS and see if you can help them.
Well, there are two good things about what you just said, Ted. One is you actually got something passed on a bipartisan basis, and two is it will probably do some good. So those are, you know, we're building back Congress is
and
what
we've
I
already,
have to say.
And I should mention, that we've already seen the hacking program be successful when Ash Carter was Secretary of Defense. I certainly applauded and encouraged the hack, the Pentagon program, which was wildly successful with that and GSA. And as a result, Kevin McCarthy and I, on a bipartisan basis, put through a bill that requires DHS now to have a vulnerability disclosure program and processes that I'd like to eventually see every department and agency have a similar type of a policy put in place, and I'm feeling more and more confident that we will.
So hanging out here yesterday with all these brilliant staffers from Congress, we were briefed by various folks, and two things were mentioned, or many more things. But one is that failure is good. Failure is your friend. You learn, well, hopefully you learn from failure. You don't just keep failing. You can fail upward and you can become smarter. That was one. And the other word that I've never heard in government was imagination. Using imagination is the way we anticipate things that can go wrong, get ahead of those who are really trying to hurt us. So let me ask the members of Congress about those two words. Does our government, is it okay in government to fail, to learn from failures, and where is the imagination in government about things like cyber?
Well, you're right on point that if you don't fail, you don't learn. It's going to be smart failure, and I mean this is somewhat related to my defense world and the subcommittee that I chair on intelligence, emerging threats, and capabilities. That you need to look at failure as an opportunity to learn. You have to foster a culture of trying things, risk-taking, but not penalizing failure, but in a sense, rewarding it or at least building in a culture. And that goes for cyber as well. But you don't learn these things unless we exercise them, that we plan. And it's not something you can just hope is going to work out. It has to be thought through, exercised, and that's why the war gaming or planning is so important.
One reason I read science fiction is for the imagination. At least that's what I tell people. So in terms of Congress,
I think it's to change the subject and get your mind off your day job.
So in terms of imagination, I think Jane makes a great point. Government certainly doesn't do enough of that. But even before you get there, I just want to understand sort of what Congress is like. Members of Congress don't really walk around thinking about encryption. That's not something they do. So you're faced with, you know, every 2 years, when these 2-year legislative cycles, we vote well over 1,000 times. And 80, 90% of those votes, we don't get a single phone call, message, email, or a meeting. And then you're asked to vote on all these different things from, you know, issues you have no idea about to issues you care a lot about. So there's not a lot of time on cyber unless you put directly in front of the member of Congress or their staff. So it's important to have conferences like DEF CON that raise awareness, and then when people read about things in the press, they might go, oh, that's sort of interesting. And one way to try to get more imagination in government is to just let people even know this problem exists so that members of Congress and their staffs start thinking about it.
Yeah, so Space Rogue, you testified 21 years ago, my God.
I'm old.
No, that doesn't make you old. Not at all.
You were 15.
Not to me.
Yeah, I was 15 then.
Yeah, you were 15. Me too. So you testified 21 years ago. What was the sophistication of the crowd you addressed? And do you think Congress is trying, through all the tasks that members have to do and what I would call the perpetual reelection campaign, do you think that Congress is trying to become more sophisticated and aware?
The committee that I addressed then was actually pretty sophisticated. I mean, it had Senator Glenn, who was an astronaut, Senator Thompson, Senator Lieberman, all very sophisticated.
None of them is there anymore.
None of them are there anymore. But the current administration or the current Congress people that I see want to be sophisticated. They want to be knowledgeable. They want to understand the issues. As we all know, some of these issues are fairly complex, and that's why they have their staffers to sort of research this stuff for them. And it's up to us as a community to engage with those agencies and those people and those staffers and those Congress people to educate them. And as Representative Lugar said, he's not getting letters from many of the bills that he's voting on. Why aren't we writing letters? Why aren't we telling them that we're saying, we're here, we're available, we're knowledgeable, look at this issue in this way, here's something you may not have thought about, whatever, get engaged, write those letters, make Congress more technical so that they understand the issues that they're voting on.
Can I ask the audience questions, show of hands? Sorry, I really like audience participation because I don't see why I should do all the work. So quick show of hands, who feels like they're pretty confident what Congress is doing around cybersecurity, like what issues they're focused on? Like, I'm somewhat confident on it. Okay. Who feels like they know what their local representation thinks about cybersecurity, like if they have a point of view on it, what their platform is, what they focus on? Okay, a little bit more. Yes.
This is pathetic, folks.
Who would actually have an interest in helping to shape better cybersecurity policy? Firstly, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's really great, like we love that. You should totally get involved. I think, you know, one thing that I would love to like sort of talk about is how you can get involved. I do think, I mean, because I think it's really challenging and it's like a little daunting.
So talk about that, all right?
Yeah.
How can they get involved? This is from an experienced hacker / policy wonk. That would be you.
Okay. And I'll say, like, when I started doing policy work, I you can hear in my accent, not American. I had no idea. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a policy person. I knew nothing whatsoever. I still think I know nothing, and yet somehow I'm sitting here, which is a little bit awkward. So what I did was, firstly, I talked to other people who were interested. So I went online, and I looked at who's talking about certain topics and introduced myself to them. Figure out what the topics are that you care about. For me, the thing that got me like angry was a really close friend of mine that's a security researcher got threatened with legal action, and was completely legitimate research. And then I learned about the CFAA. Who loves the CFAA? Yeah, that's what
Good.
I thought. Fantastic. So that was my issue, was like I was all fired up about the CFAA. So I went and figured out who talks about the CFAA, who's been working on that. And I went and made friends with them. And then from those people, I figured out which particular committees do things around crime and the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. So that was the judiciary committees. So I looked up who were on those committees, and I literally just sort of reached out to the offices of the people who were on those committees and said, you know, I'd like to come and talk to you about security. And what I found was, when I sent these emails, people were like, oh, cybersecurity? Yeah, that's totally a thing we're looking at. Come in and talk to us. And then I kind of got inundated with like, can you talk about encryption? Can you talk about breach notification? Can you talk about this, that, and the other? Because they were actually crying out for people who could talk about cybersecurity and were willing to give the time. So there's real interest. All you have to do is like do a little bit of research. It is hard. I'm not trying to minimize it. It's daunting.
I mean, there's also local government, state, town, city. Yeah. Don't forget them. They need just as much information as the federal government. If you don't want to work directly with government, there are a lot of other organizations that work with government for you that you can work with. For example, the Bar Association is trying to put together a framework for protecting security researchers. So if you're a lawyer and you want to work on that, you can, I don't know, contact me, I guess. But there's tons of things that you can do to get involved and help be engaged.
All right, so Josh Corman's waggling his eyebrows at me, so I'm going to say I am the Cavalry is another great way of getting involved.
Josh.
They do a lot of work with policymakers, and they can help keep you informed. There are ways of doing it.
So let's talk about something that is absolutely critical to our democracy, not that a lot of this isn't, but the 2020 election, and whether or not, the answer is not, our voting machines are secure. I went yesterday with Jim to the, I guess it was the voting village, to get briefed, and I learned, not that you all don't know that, that at least a third of voting machines, the ones you push and that have no paper trail, are totally vulnerable. One third in this country, one third. And there are lots of efforts, especially from this audience, to try to come up with some ideas that are affordable to election districts and would add security. How many of you, I like this idea of show of hands, if not asked, how many of you would like to work on this problem? Well, that's pretty good, Jim. What do you think?
I think it's great. The vulnerability in election systems does concern me, and especially when you're talking about touchscreen technology without a hard copy paper ballot. So this is an area where my experience in government kind of crosses a few different domains. Certainly the interest in cyber, but I served as Secretary of State in Rhode Island. I overhauled our election system. I chaired a special legislative commission looking at different technologies, and I could never get over the feeling that what if everything went south and somehow the data was lost, and not even thinking about hacking at the time, but how do you recreate the election? And instead of going with touch screens, we went with an optical scan system. I think that's the best model going forward. But there are many locations that have already invested in this, the touch screen technology, and they're not ready, willing, or able to transition over. That's why I think federal resources have to be provided to states and municipalities so that they can purchase that new equipment. But certainly engaging with the security community is important. It's essential. And I can give a couple of examples, by the way, which already happened where cybersecurity researchers had an impact. Not election focused, but this is on the Wassenaar arrangement, on NTIA's multi-stakeholder process on vulnerability disclosures, and also the FDA and their pre- and post-market guidance on medical devices. This is an area where cyber researchers in this community have already had an impact by reaching out to your legislators and people in the policy world, and you can help better inform us as we make good public policy.
Ken.
So one way to make things better, for example, in the voting areas, to simply make these machines less susceptible to hacking. The other way is to help pass laws that will mandate these private companies to do the right thing. So the House of Representatives, on a bipartisan basis, has passed two bills to the U.S. Senate. One is their H.R. 1 for the People Act, has a number of election security measures in there. And then we also passed the SAFE Act, focused just on election security. It does simple things, like require a paper trail. Senator Mitch McConnell has refused to take those bills up for a vote. And my view is that Abraham Lincoln had it right when he said that public sentiment is everything. With it, nothing can fail. Without it, nothing can succeed.
So let's pause there. What Ted just said, translated in simple sentences, is the House has passed a couple of very strong bills, and they are languishing in the United States Senate. How many of you live in places that have senators? And what should you now do?
Vote.
Well, Call your senator.
Yes.
To get what are the numbers of these bills, Ted?
One is H.R. 1. The other is called the SAFE Act. So I want you to understand your power to shape public sentiment. So one way is, for example, what Jane and Jim just did yesterday and went and saw this village where they're hacking voting machines, just letting the public know, hey, these things can be hacked, or letting the press know. And then it puts pressure, right, on senators to start taking action, just making the issue rise higher in level in the public's awareness. So understand your power to do that. And if people start reading voices of hackers, if they read people with expertise talking about these issues, I think that can help change public sentiment.
So we're almost out of time, but I did want to ask Space Rogue and Jen, now that you've heard some very, I think, positive suggestions from well-informed members of Congress, whether you are optimistic that somehow this divide between the hacker community and this analog community called the United States Congress, not these members, can be breached, and that, you know, what will you personally do after this little conversation to help get everyone else involved?
I'm optimistic. I've been optimistic for the last 20 years. And I think that's one of the important lessons that I've had to learn and struggle with because, you know, as hackers, we want things done now, right? Okay, I'm going to hack it. Okay, it's done. Congress and government and the corporation I work for now doesn't work that way. They do not work at the speed of hack. And so it takes 20 years to go from hackers at Congress to Congress at DEF CON. And I'm still very optimistic. I'm very happy that you all are here. And I am going to go forward and hopefully continue to encourage people to get involved and be engaged.
Last word, Jen.
Yeah, I mean, obviously we wouldn't be up here if we were going to be like, no, I'm pessimistic, bro. So yes, I'm also optimistic. And I'm optimistic not just because we have the congressman here, but also because of the number of you who turn out to hear them and the number of you who put your hands up saying that you want to help shape policy in the right way. Like, that makes me really optimistic. The thing that I would say, you know, just adding on to Space's comment about time, is also that the way that Congress works is it's sort of an evolution. And we all in the tech sector tend to live in a bit of a binary world. We can be a bit absolutist about things. And I think if you're going to engage, the thing to recognize is it's a process, it's a journey. You'll make incremental progress. It won't be like one and done. So try not to be too absolutist as you approach it. What am I going to do? Well, I will say, if anybody wants help in getting involved, come find me. I'm InfoSec Jen. I'm always happy to help people. And I will see you guys in DC in 2 weeks.
Yeah. Great. Jim and Ted each has a word, and I'll sign off before they speak by saying this is one community, and it has to include our political community. That divide has to be crossed, because if it's not crossed, think what the consequences are. So please help Congress. Jim Langevin, last word, and then Ted Lieu.
Thank you, Jane. I really enjoyed the discussion and being on the panel today with these outstanding panelists. And let me just close by saying this. If you take away nothing from the panel discussion, is that you can get involved and have an impact. I know it has to be frustrating that, you know, when you see a problem, you just want it to be fixed and do it immediately. And as technologists, often you can do that. Write a program, fix the problem. Unfortunately, public policy making doesn't always work that fast, and it's to our great frustration. There are many things, if I were king for a day, I guess I would, I could fix it overnight, but the policy making process can be slow, cumbersome, and difficult. But I will say this, when in making good public policy, three things have to line up. You have a problem, a solution, and a window of opportunity. They don't often wind up lining up easily or quickly, but when they do, you have to be willing to push it and ready to push it across the finish line. That's where you can come in. I would say right now, get in touch with your member of Congress, House, your senator, know their staffs, ping them once or twice a year. Let them know that you're there as a resource. We've got incredibly smart people on our staffs, but they don't know everything, and we can use more resources, we can use your expertise. We welcome your input, and your involvement can make a huge difference.
Well, 15 really smart congressional staffers are at DEF CON, and they'll be here through tomorrow, so you can find them. And they work for Republicans and Democrats across the country in senior jobs, so be sure to lobby them. Ted, the very last word.
Thank you. So just two quick points. Not only can you assist the federal government, you can work on issues that will help consumers. So for example, Jim Landrieu has introduced a bill on notification for privacy breaches. You've had companies that have gotten breached, they had the customer's information breached, and then they didn't disclose it for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks, and you had consumers that could have protected themselves. So you can also work on issues not just affecting federal government, but affecting Americans in general. And then let me conclude on this. My view of politics is that everything seems impossible until it happens. So if 10 years ago I were to tell you, hey, in 10 years we're going to have gay marriage in 50 states, and in a number of them we're going to be smoking weed, you'd think I was crazy. That's what's happening now. So you never know when public sentiment shifts and causes something to happen. Thank you for being here.
On that note, thank you all for coming.